Men and Rubber, The Story of Business, by Harvey S. Firestone, an autobiography, narrated by Merwin Smith. Thomas A. Edison sums it up this way. There is no expedient to which a man will not go to avoid the real labor of thinking. He has had it posted on signs about his laboratories. He has said it to me a dozen times and illustrated it with cases. He and Henry Ford often discuss it, and I have often discussed it with Mr. Edison. For the most difficult thing in business is first getting yourself to thinking and then getting others to thinking. I say this is difficult because in the natural course of business, an infinite number of details come up every day, and it is very easy indeed to keep so busy with these details that no time is left over for hard, quiet thought, for thinking through from the beginning to the end. An executive cannot grandly dismiss details. Business is made up of details, and I notice that the chief executive who dismisses them is quite as likely as not to dismiss his business. I believe in one-man control. No business is large enough to survive divided authority. Some one man must be supreme, and that man whose authority is supreme, whether or not he be the titular head of the business, has to find the time not only to know the necessary day-to-day details and progress, but also for quiet, sustained thought. A man may keep very busy indeed without doing any thinking at all, and the easy course, the course of least resistance, is to keep so busy that there will be no time left over for thought. Almost every man tries to dodge thought or to find a substitute for it. We try to buy thoughts ready-made and guaranteed to fit in the shape of systems installed by experts. We try to substitute discussion for thought by organizing committees. A committee may function very well indeed as a clearinghouse for thoughts, but more commonly a committee organization is just an elaborate means of fooling oneself into believing that a spell spent in talking is the same as a spell spent in thinking. Take Mr. Ford. He knows every necessary detail of the far-flung Ford Industries. He always knows what is going on, but he never tends to the execution of details. He does not waste time in dictating and signing notes and letters, or in seeing people whom it is not necessary for him to see. He delegates all this to others. He has assigned no executive duties whatsoever to himself. In fact, he does not even have a desk. He has only a few friends and no social obligations at all, and so he keeps himself free to think and to plan and to watch. It is commonly imagined that Mr. Ford arrives at his decisions quickly. Nothing could be farther from the fact. He reaches his decisions slowly and alone. He does not jump at anything, and so, when the time comes for execution, everything moves with marvelous rapidity because everything has been previously thought through and planned. He has had the time to do this thinking and planning because he has used his time himself instead of permitting others to use it for him. And he is certain that the plans will be executed for him because he knows how to let men go when they grow too rich and lazy to execute. It is really a misnomer to call the directing head of an enterprise an executive. He cannot possibly be an executive and hold enough time back to think. The execution must be done by others, and one of the vital, ever-present problems as a company grows wealthy, is keeping executives on the job of executing. Men are apt to swell up and get lazy, and then no price is too high to pay to get rid of them. Mr. Ford manages to keep his people ever quick and active, and in the rare case of a man slowing down in order to get leisure to spend money, Mr. Ford always spots him and gradually relieves him of his more important duties, and finally puts him in a quiet backwater with nothing to do. Mr. Edison is a profound thinker. His mind is very different from that of Mr. Ford in that while Mr. Ford thinks both creatively and commercially, Mr. Edison thinks almost wholly creatively and does not give the same order of thought to commerce that he gives to creation. Neither man is an inventor in the ordinary sense, for they do not stumble upon things by accident. They start with what they want to achieve and then think out the methods of achievement. Mr. Edison's whole life has been devoted to training his mind to concentrated thinking. He will work for hours and days without food or sleep, and he can do this because he has so trained his mind that it shuts out everything except the specific problem before him. Business is founded on thought. Optimism and enthusiasm are valuable in keeping up the morale of an organization. They are lubricants which help to overcome friction, but they cannot be the driving power, and they cannot substitute for well-thought-out business principles any more than a machine will run just because it is well-oiled. Power has to be transmitted before a wheel will turn.
We give various names to the thought which has the power to turn the wheels. Sometimes we call it management. But there is another kind of management which is not based on thought, and which is not management at all. For instance, there is the kind of management which operates solely on records. Records will guide thought, but they will not substitute for thought. Good management, that is management with real thought behind it, does not bother trying to make its way by trickery, for it knows that fundamental honesty is the keystone of the arch of business. It knows that you will fail if you think more of matching competitors than of giving service, that you will fail if you put money or profits ahead of work, and that there is no reason why you should succeed if what you do does not benefit others. This is not idealistic philosophy. It is the hardest kind of hard common sense. If you ask yourself why you are in business and can find no answer other than, I want to make money, you will save money by getting out of business and going to work for someone, for you are in business without sufficient reason. A business which exists without a reason is due for an early death. The single reason for the existence of any business must be that it supplies a human need or want. And if my experience is worth anything, a business which has this reason for its existence will be bound in the end to prosper if thought be put into it. Thought, not money, is the real business capital. And if you know absolutely that what you are doing is right, then you are bound to accomplish it in due season. I say this not because I read it somewhere in a book, but because I have lived it. For if there is any phase of adversity which our business has not met and beaten, I should like to know it. We chartered the present Firestone Tire and Rubber Company in 1900, making solid tires for carriage wheels. I had a capital of $45,000, which I had earned in a previous carriage tire company. We had scarcely begun business before we were faced with a great patent suit, second perhaps only to the famous Selden patent suit. We had only a little factory with 10 men, and I was general manager and sales manager and every other kind of manager. Our capital ran quickly out, and as our business grew, it had to be financed by bank loans and sales of stock. I not only had to sell the tires we made, but also the shares of stock to get the money to make more tires. For years, I rarely met a man who seemed to have any money without trying to sell him stock. I sold it to officers of banks with which we did business. I sold it to the people from whom we bought our supplies. I sold it to our own employees, and I bought it myself whenever I could find a bank which would take it as collateral. We financed from hand to mouth, but steadily we grew, and we grew in the face of great tire companies who could have bought us out of their current bank balances. I sold the stock in the absolute confidence that I was doing a favor to whoever bought it, and in that I was right. For instance, I induced an officer of a steel corporation with which we did business to take, in the first few years, stock to the value of $7,500. For some years, he got nothing in return for his money. Today, his holdings have a market value of $900,000. We grew from the little building we first bought to larger buildings, and for many years we could not increase our manufacturing capacity in pace with the orders that came in. We fought and won other great patent suits, the loss of any one of which would have wiped us out of existence. Our original 10 employees grew to 17,000. We passed from the solid carriage tire to the various forms of automobile tires. Our sales went up to around $100 million a year, and our capacity from around 40 tires a day to around 40,000. We built up on the side a rim-making business, which supplies half the manufacturers of passenger cars and trucks in the country. From only a few scattered salesmen, we grew to 62 factory branch houses, 75 warehouses, and 36,000 dealers in the United States. And in addition, we founded more than 100 foreign branches and distributors. We applied Mr. Ford's ideas of production and cut out more than half of the hand labor of making tires, which largely increased the average wage of the employees while reducing the price of tires to the consumers. We built a factory in Canada and a rubber mill in Singapore in the Straits Settlements, so that we might save waste in the transport of rubber. We built 1,000 homes or more for our employees, and in the year 1919, we earned more than $9 million, and our total assets exceeded $70 million, of which nearly one half was surplus. We had $4 in current assets to every dollar of current liabilities. We were sailing smoothly with the wind, and we were so strong that we thought nothing could harm us. We had all the bank credit we could possibly use. We dwelt on Easy Street and walked on velvet. Then, in the fall of 1920, Not out of a clear sky, but out of a sky which looked clear to us, for in our prosperity we had stopped thinking through. The tornado swept out, gripped us, and shook us. I was in Europe at the time. Rubber dropped from 55 cents to 16 cents a pound, and with it crashed our tremendous inventories. We owed the banks nearly $44 million, and some of them wanted their money, and we had no money. I personally owed the banks several million dollars, with Firestone stock as collateral, for whenever I could buy any stock, I bought it. I put everything I earned into this stock, for I believe that a man is not truly in his business unless he has his all in it. The value of this stock had in a few days dropped below the amount of the loans it secured. Both the company's fortune and my personal fortune were hanging out on the end of a limb which threatened at any moment to break. It was a time for quick thinking, but above all for thorough thinking. And in the excitement, everything made for taking action instead of taking thought. But first I took thought, and I took counsel, and then I took action, with the result that we reduced our bank loans $12 million in a couple of months. We ranged up nearly all our banks so that they did everything to help us and nothing to hinder us. We reorganized the inside workings of our company, both in manufacturing and selling. We started to think again, and we carried on through the dullest years the tire industry has ever experienced, to such good purpose that by October 1924, we had paid off every dollar of bank indebtedness and were in far sounder condition than at any previous period. And now, although I date the foundation of the company historically from 1900, I regard those first 20 years only as a period of preparation for the real test of 1920. A business is not a business until it has been hardened by fire and water. What we lost in the boom, what everyone lost, was the appraisal of values. It does not require any thought to do business in a period of rising prices, and we had gotten out of the way of thinking. Instead of comparing values, the continued rise in prices covered up our mistakes, and it took a great shock to bring us to our senses and make us again appraise values. Much of the thinking in business has to be along the lines of comparing values. If we make a change in manufacturing or in selling methods, will the added return pay the cost? This appraising operation in business is continuous. For instance, in 1920, when we began to compare expenditures and results in our office, we promptly discovered that instead of 1,500 office employees, we actually needed only 300. Or in other words, we had 1,200 men performing operations of no value to us. We found an even worse situation in selling. In a period when no selling was necessary, since people rushed in to buy, we had built up, because we had lost our sense of values, a most intricate organization that could not possibly pay its way. It was being paid for by rising prices, and not by work. Many of the values are intangible, and cannot be put down on paper in terms of dollars and cents. But this is the point. If you can make a picture of a situation in your own mind, then you can make comparisons and relate values, even if you cannot express them. Some people call this vision, and we hear a deal about the necessity for vision. But vision, as I see it, is not a dreaming forward. It is a thinking through with the values ever in mind. For instance, I should not be exercising vision if I looked forward to a day when I should supply all the tires in the world. That would be just idle, profitless dreaming. In quite another class is thinking out ways and means to get a certain percentage of all the tires used, and then relating prices and manufacturing schedules and so on to that end. It is perfectly possible to make an exact mental picture of what would be required to do a decided percentage of business. And if that picture be kept in mind, the decisions to carry it out can come quickly. Quick decisions that have not behind them a long train of thought are exceedingly dangerous. Personally, I do not want to have around me the kind of man who can give me an instant decision on anything I may bring up, for if he has not had the opportunity to give the question serious thought, then he is only guessing, and I can do my own guessing. In order to do any good-sized work, one has to build an organization of executives and of employees, and as a business grows, the task is to discover how many of the men will think and how many will just execute orders. There is plenty of room for both kinds of men. The man who only executes is extremely valuable, unless he happens to get into a position where thought is required. The Army recognizes this. It not only does not expect the private to think, but actually punishes him for any thought that causes him not to obey orders to the letter, be they right or wrong. Thinking is not required all the way down the line in business. The difficulty is to pick out the men who can and will think and get them into the positions where thought is needed. For instance, a salesman can be a one-act man and still be a success. By one-act man, I mean a man who shows a great knowledge of his subject and is really impressive until you happen to get him off his exact line of talk. Then you find that his talk is only an act which he has mastered, that his cleverness is only the repeating of lines which someone else has written. When he has finished his act, he is through. The great trouble with this sort of man is that he may spring his whole act at the wrong time and in the wrong place. Then one is frequently fooled by the glibness of failures. A man who is a first-class failure, who has had plenty of experience in failing, commonly will talk his head off. He will tell considerably more than he knows. While a thoughtful man will often be none too ready with his answers, and usually will tell a little less than he knows. It is the affair of the head of a business to think and to plan broadly, and then to select other men who can think and plan within their particular spheres, and finally to select men who can execute. And then, when you have made your selections of men, they are at their best only tentative, for only 1 out of every 100 men can stand the test of prosperity without losing his sense of values, and fewer still can face adversity without digging in. This is a queer business of ours. It has changed mightily in 25 years. Once upon a time, we sold on mere style. Now we have to sell on service, on what we can give a man for his money. And further, we have to use as our principal raw materials 2 products which we cannot control and whose prices are continually shifting, that is, rubber and cotton. We have every problem of manufacturing which any business can have. Also, we have every problem of selling, for competition is intense. We have seasonal peaks and valleys of demand. We have problems of finance and of forecasting markets, for our production could not, without great waste, meet the peak of demand. We have had one of the biggest booms in history, and also one of the biggest smashes. In short, we have had a little of everything which business can face, and a good deal of some things. But we are here, and prospering. It has required some thinking through. My father, Benjamin Firestone, was, by and large, the best businessman I have ever known. The test of a businessman is not whether he can make money in 1 or 2 boom years, or can make money through the luck of getting into the field first, but whether in a highly competitive field, without having any initial advantage over his competitors, he can outdistance them in a perfectly honorable way and keep the respect of himself and of his community. My father did just that. I have just called him a businessman, and that he was. But technically he was a farmer, and as far as I can recall, he never entered into any strictly business enterprise. Our farm at Columbiana, Ohio, which now belongs to me, and where I often take groups of employees on outings, was no better and no worse than the surrounding farms. But year in and year out, my father gained from it upward of $2,000 a year in cash, which was a lot of money for a farmer to earn in the 70s and 80s out of a couple of 100 acres of land. Sometimes he had especially good seasons when he earned more, but, which is to the point, he never had any really bad seasons, for he seemed always to be able so to balance his affairs that a crop failure which swamped his neighbors did not even touch him. And I think this was due to the fact that he always had some money on the side, and was therefore able to use his best judgment under the circumstances, instead of being forced into a decision by financial pressure. As I grew older, I usually went with him on his trips to buy or sell cattle or sheep, and it was a whole course in trading to watch him at work. First he saw the whole market and heard what everyone had to offer or say, saying almost nothing himself. He often told me, "Never rush in on a deal. Let it come to you." That is the course he followed, and by the time he was ready to trade, he knew the whole market. If his survey convinced him that the market was not a good one either to buy or to sell in, he simply went home again. He often held his stock a year to get better prices, and he was so good a judge of conditions that I do not recall that he ever made a mistake by holding. If the market were high and seemed to be going higher, he would seldom wait long to sell, and he never held back in the hope that the prices would soar to some impossible figure. Although he probably had never heard of Baron Rothschild's advice never to buy at the top or sell at the bottom, he literally followed it. He never wanted to get more than his stock was worth, or to buy stock for less than it was worth, which is probably the reason why everyone in the market respected him and dealt with him fairly. And also in a day when few farmers read anything, He was a wide reader and accumulated a large fund of knowledge, which is one of the reasons why he was a good farmer. I noticed that when all a man's information is confined to the field in which he is working, the work is never as good as it ought to be. A man has to get a perspective, and he can get it from books or from people, preferably from both. This thing of sleeping and eating with your business can easily be overdone. It is all well enough, usually necessary in times of trouble. But as a steady diet, it does not make for good business. A man ought now and then to get far enough away to have a look at himself and his affairs. Otherwise, he gets lost in the details and forgets what he is really doing. One often sees that in foremen. Although I did not dislike farm work, it was the buying and selling of stock, and especially of horses, that most attracted me. And by the time I was 15, I could hold my own with anyone in a horse trade. For first of all, I knew horses and loved them. And then my father trained me, as I have said, never to rush in on a deal. I cannot give any principles for horse trading. It is an art, not a science, and it has to start with liking to be with horses and to know them. Ever since I was a boy, no matter how hard up I might happen to be, I seldom was without at least one horse, and that was always a good one. We were fortunate in having a first-class high school at Columbiana, and after I graduated from that, I spent 3 months at the Spencerian Business College in Cleveland, getting ready to enter business. Our family business ideal of the time was my father's first cousin, Clinton D. Firestone, the principal owner of the Columbus Buggy Company, which was then the most important in the United States, turning out those fine-looking, expensive buggies which years ago it was the ambition of every farmer to own. My older brother Elmer was already working in the company, and I wanted very much to get there. For 9 months I worked in the shipping room. Then he promoted me to salesman in the Columbus showroom, where I learned how to sell buggies. Our Des Moines branch got into considerable trouble, and my cousin, remembering that I was a bookkeeper, sent me out to put it straight. I stayed there for some months until things were in working order, when I was shifted to the Detroit agency as a bookkeeper. I had by then developed no great liking for keeping books, and I managed to edge into the showroom during my spare time and help sell. As a result, I got entirely into the sales end, and was given the district outside of Detroit. Then I began to come into my own and make some money. In this, my first prosperity, I met Miss Ida Bell Smith. On November 20th, 1895, we were married, I being then 27 years old and rated as a successful businessman. But this prosperity was not long to continue. Our company sold a very fine buggy which cost $110, while Durant, Dort, Nash, and some others whose names afterward also became famous in the automobile field, were bringing out good, strong buggies to sell at $35. For a while, the farmers, who could afford it, bought our more expensive buggy as a matter of pride, but they soon began to find out that they were throwing their money away, and that it was cheaper to buy the less expensive buggy and get a new one every few years rather than hang on to our old expensive affair. Our business gradually fell off throughout the country, although I did a fair business in Michigan, and just a few months after I was married, our company failed, leaving me without a job. But this time, with the responsibility of a wife and a home. I did some selling for the receiver of the company during the next several months, but this was not enough to keep me going, and I kept my eyes open for other work. Driving out one afternoon in my rubber-tired buggy, it for the first time struck me that my future was right on the wheels of my buggy. Those rubber tires were the only ones in Detroit. They were not the only ones in the United States, and a London cab company had already fitted out all its cabs with rubber tires, but they were hard to buy in the United States. Why not make them easy to buy? I had about $1,000 saved, which was not enough to start business on. I knew that. I cast about among my friends and selected a man who I thought would make a good partner and who had money. Then I invited him for a drive, and I took some pains to let him realize how much easier the riding was than with steel-rimmed wheels. Actually, I was making a demonstration, but without any proposition. I wanted him to sell himself before I did any talking. We had dinner together, and I told him what I had in mind, that if he and I both thought that rubber tires were a great improvement over steel, others could be made to think likewise, and we had before us a new business that might grow to any extent. Of course, I figured out the number of buggies in the United States, and then said that if we sold only one half of those owners, we could have a business like Standard Oil. At length he agreed with me, and said he would go into the business. He was from Chicago and recalled an old run-down rubber factory there on Wabash Avenue near Harrison Street, which he thought could be bought cheaply. That very night, we took the train for Chicago and within a couple of days had taken over the factory for $1,500 cash. The machinery in it did not amount to anything, but we did not need much machinery, for we intended to buy our tires in strips that looked a deal like garden hose, except that they were solid, and then simply cut the strips to buggy wheel size and cement the ends together. The tires of those days slipped on like baby carriage tires, and one workman and I were at first enough to attend to all the business. When I sold a set of tires, I took the buggy wheels back to the shop, and the workman and I cut the rubber tire to size and cemented it on the wheel over the steel rim. We got about $40 for a set of tires, which cost us about $14. We paid $40 a month rent for the shop. Our cash capital was around $500. With that, we organized the Firestone Victor Rubber Company, which later became the Firestone Rubber Tire Company. From the very beginning, we prospered. Once a man rode on rubber tires, he wanted a set. Although we did not sell many nationally, we did sell in Chicago. But we had not enough money to expand and to swing our stocks. We bought our rubber at first from the Morgan and Wright Company at Chicago, and later from the India Rubber and Diamond Rubber Companies at Akron. These big rubber companies were better equipped to do a carriage tire business than we were, but they did not seem quite to understand tires. And then, too, the volume of the business was small. It was just a specialty. All of the active management was in my hands. The production end did not give much trouble, for it was simple enough. But the finances, far from simple. Their complexity was not due to the size of the operations. I could state our condition, in those days, right out of my head, and the back of an envelope gave ample space for the statement. Our trouble was that we did not have enough money and did not know how to get it. I did sell the Morgan and Wright Company on giving us a credit of $1,000, but I did not know anything about getting a line of credit at a bank. The only way open, or so it seemed to me, was to get more money invested, and it is not easy to persuade people to put money into a new enterprise. However, I did persuade one of my friends to come with us for a small amount, and that helped for a while. But we were growing faster than our capital, which meant that we were always short of money. Near our little plant was the more modern plant of the Imperial Rubber Company, and one day its proprietor offered to sell out to me lock, stock, and barrel for $15,000. He had not been able to make money against the competition of the big rubber companies. We did not have that much money, but the plant seemed to be a good buy, and I set out to raise the money. And for the first time, I entered a bank with the intention of borrowing money. I shall not mention the name of the bank, for we never afterward did business with it. I talked with the president for a few moments, and then he turned me over to the credit man. I had with me a statement from our books, which I had prepared myself, because as a bookkeeper I was used to making up statements, and I kept the books of the concern. The credit man read the statement carefully. I have forgotten what sort of a statement it was, but since it was a true statement, it probably showed our liquid assets as small, less than our current liabilities. For almost everything we had was tied up in plant, equipment, and raw materials. I did not at the time know that bank loans are made on the basis of quick assets, and that banks do not commonly care to go into the investment business. If we had assets and prospects, it did not bother me at all what form they were in. The credit man led me on to explain the statement, and I thought that I was selling our future. I told the story of the business we were doing, and how much we needed money to expand and take over the new plant, and what we expected to do with the money. He seemed to grow more interested as I proceeded, and I thought to myself that when I had finished he would recommend giving me the bank. But he was just giving me the opportunity to show how little I knew about finance. He was not frank about it. I left that bank thinking I was going to get a loan, and while I was never refused the loan, I never got it. However, I did learn something. What I learned was that a bank statement ought never to be in such shape that it has to be explained. Everything ought to be on the statement, and if for some reason an explanation of an item is asked for, then one should be able to present facts and not prospects. A statement of condition can be a prospectus. In fact, it is the best possible kind of a prospectus, but it ought not to be prepared in enthusiasm. It ought to be absolutely frank and entirely conservative. Then an explanation will show that actual conditions are a little better and not a little worse than represented. A young fellow gets anxious, and he will, with perfect sincerity, paint far too rosy a picture. I do not blame that bank man for turning me down, but I do blame him for leading me on. Thinking the incident over, I saw that I had rushed in instead of going in cautiously and with a full knowledge of the facts. Another mistake I had made was in trying to borrow money from a bank without vision instead of from a bank with vision, although I had found out in selling that it did not pay to deal with small people. In a day or two, I had my new plans all worked out, and I went to a big bank, to the First National, and was turned over to a young officer whose manner attracted me extraordinarily, for he seemed to sympathize with me and want to help me. And goodness knows I needed both help and sympathy, for while I was willing to take a shy at being a financier, my partners would not go even that far. If any money were to be raised, I had to raise it. This young man went into my statement. He asked me direct questions about my business, and I answered them frankly and honestly. I did not make the mistake of overselling him. Incidentally, we did not have an account in that bank, and I had just come in off the street without an introduction of any sort. But this bank officer did not bring up opening an account. He showed me where I had made mistakes in financial management. He told me something about how I should try to keep a ratio between quick assets and liabilities. And in an hour, not only found out all about what we were doing, but also gave me a course in practical banking. Then he lent me $10,000 on the company note. The young man's name was Frank O. Wetmore, and today he is president of the bank and one of the best friends our company has. He gave me my first lessons in banking, and while we did business in Chicago, I never made a move without first talking it over with him. Today I never go to Chicago without going in to see him, for he is as much of an advisor now as he was then. And I may say that very shortly we opened an account with the First National and have been doing business with it ever since. If you want help, it pays to go where the brains are. I had no idea that bank money cannot safely be used for capital investments. It is entirely true that it ought not to be, but the man who can build a business on small capital and preserve fine distinctions as to the use of the money he borrows is yet to be born, and every banker of experience knows it. We bought the new factory largely with the bank money and some additional money we raised. Our assets had risen to a total of $40,000 on a most conservative basis, but also we had plenty of liabilities. The rubber tire wheel company appeared in the market with a wheel especially made for taking rubber tires, which was much superior to our crude method. They threatened to drive us out of business, so I decided to persuade them to consolidate with us, even though they had assets of around $200,000. It was not hard to show that if the two of us kept in the field, neither would make money, and in due course, we consolidated. The result made us the biggest factor in the buggy tire business. In fact, I once placed an order in Akron for $500,000 worth of tires. The consolidated company, forming as a trust to take over all the rubber companies of the country, made an offer to buy us out. We made no haste to accept. We traded back and forth a little and finally sold out for $1,254,000, or something more than four times what our business was worth, not counting its goodwill. Out of the payments, I received $45,000 in cash, which was considerably more money than I had thought was in the world for me. Of this sum, I invested $20,000 in a 6% mortgage so that I might have a steady income to fall back on. The other $25,000 I kept in the bank in cash, ready to see what might turn up. We'd been in business only about 4 years, and my original $1,000 had grown to $45,000. Starting the company. Having some money in hand, I wanted to go into business for myself. If a man has no capital, it is usually a waste of time for him to start in business on his own, unless he can borrow capital for a long term at low interest. But the chances of success on borrowed capital are slight. It is not possible in beginning a new enterprise to see ahead far enough to discover how much capital really will be needed. It is unusual and indeed abnormal for a concern to make money during the first several years of its existence. The initial product and the initial organization are never right. The first product, no matter how thoroughly it has been thought out, has to be seasoned in the market. An experienced company with ample resources can make extensive laboratory tests, and also tests in use, for a long period before bringing out a product, and can reduce many of the elements of luck and risk. But it cannot know in advance either how the public will receive that product or how it will stand up at actual service. The new company will think that it has taken every precaution. It will think that it has made every sort of an investigation, but really the most searching trials that a new company can make are of small moment. First, because the promoters can never get themselves into the cold, detached frame of mind in which the public approaches anything new. And second, because the knowledge of what really is a test will be lacking. The business of any live company has to be constantly revised, but with a new company, these revisions have to be drastic. In the exceptional case where the product itself does not have to be revamped, its method of manufacture will have to be changed. And if neither the product nor its manufacture has to be changed, then most certainly the human organization, be it 3 men or 1,000, will prove inadequate. It is difficult enough to pick men in a seasoned business, but then one has at least the advantage of knowing something about the required duties. In starting a new business, although a paper organization may be put down in a small way, the eventual organization will turn out to be something very different. It is always cut and try in business, but in the beginning, this cutting and trying have to go on so rapidly that there is not much chance really to make money. It may be possible in exceptional cases to pay the interest on borrowed capital, but unless one strikes a bonanza, any undertaking quickly to pay back borrowed capital is bound to result in failure. It is more than unsafe. It is just a waste of time to start into business with money that has not been embarked, for better or for worse. That is, money which demands no return other than the profits the business can afford, which means money invested in stock, and in common stock rather than preferred. Also, it is exceedingly unwise to hold out any promises of quick returns, although it is human nature to do so. For if a new business does succeed, it will have to be uncommonly careful in the distribution of profits. If you are going ahead, you will need every cent you can lay your hands on to finance operations, and the more of these operations you can finance with your own money, the better off you are. A business which starts off quickly, makes money at once, and seems to be in every respect a gold mine, often does not last long. It is just selling peanuts to the crowd in town for the circus, a once-around affair. I thought I had money enough to go into business. I had $45,000, and I was strongly advised that it was too much money to hazard in business, that it was a fortune to retire on. At that time, it was the desire of every ambitious young man to have his own business. The great corporation had not yet gotten underway, with the exception of the Standard Oil Company, which was thought of more as a mysterious phenomenon than as a type for future business. Today it hardly pays a young man to go into business for himself unless he has a new idea which he cannot sell to anyone. I had the capital, but I did not have an idea. I knew the carriage business, and I knew the carriage tire business. I had no hankering after the carriage business, for it had become one of keen competition and cheap models. That had wrecked my uncle's buggy business. The gasoline automobile was not then a factor and gave no promise of being what it is today. The few cars on the road were mostly of foreign makes and owned by rich men, and although not exactly toys, they were certainly not commercial products. I believed thoroughly in rubber tires. They made riding so much easier that they appeared to me to be a necessity. The tires had not been developed to a point where they could economically be used on the heavier delivery wagons and trucks. But that development was only a question of time. I am speaking of solid and cushioned tires, for at that time I did not see any advantage in pneumatics, and I did see a great many disadvantages in them. Time has proved that I was right about rubber tires in general, for there is hardly a motor-drawn vehicle in the world without them. I have revised my opinion about pneumatics, but I still retain a strong liking for cushioned tires, which is probably the reason why our present company makes so many of them for heavy duty. Before I really had a chance to make up my mind about the future, the Kelly Springfield Tire Company offered me the position of manager in Chicago, and I took it. The sales policy of the company did not prove to my liking. The practice was to charge tires at the cost of material and labor, and on top of that a royalty. This seemed to me essentially unsound. The seller ought to make an inclusive price and have done with it. In about 8 months, I took a vacation, and in Cleveland made up my mind to get out and sent in my resignation. Then I set about the organization of a tire company of my own. I had no difficulty in raising the money, and the company would have gone through, but the bankers who were helping in the promotion had on their hands a piece of property which they were extremely anxious to get rid of. They insisted that we take it as a factory, in spite of the fact that it was in no way suited for tire making. If the organizers of a corporation cannot agree at the beginning, there is small chance that they will afterward, so I simply dropped the negotiations. A company in Akron, manufacturing twist drills and drop forgings, also had a tire department, but not a satisfactory tire, so they took license on a tire I had developed and patented and asked me to be its manager. I accepted, but once more the policy did not suit me. This time, instead of resigning, I took an option to buy the department. Akron was the home of the rubber tire industry. It was a good town for any man interested in tire making, for the big Goodrich, Goodyear, and Diamond factories were there, and also plenty of workmen who knew tires. The tire trade was largely in solid tires, and in the single-tube pneumatics used on bicycles. Pneumatic tires were not popular for carriages. They gave easier riding, it is true, but under the extra weight of a carriage, their single tubes punctured easily, and they were a nuisance.